We are the impact team. We have taken over all systems in your entire office. Ashley Madison must shut down immediately. We will release all customer records, sexual fantasies, nude pictures, and employee emails. Welcome to your worst fucking nightmare.
Long before I launched Ashley Madison, there were affairs, and long after I'm gone, there'll be affairs. And so what I'm just trying to do is help people have the more perfect affair.
Biederman says he built a billion-dollar business betting on infidelity. 25 million members in 37 countries.
My phone started dancing across the table. It was crazy.
They made it sound like it was this playland of people hooking up.
It has glamour, sex, crime, hacking, and danger.
It had everything.
Kind of a quick hookup kind of site.
This is the story of a website and the rise and fall of its ambitious founder, Noel Biederman. The audacious AshleyMadison.com was set up in 2001 as a safe place to arrange illicit affairs. By 2006, the site had 1.1 million users in North America and had launched in Europe. Its growth after that was extraordinary.
But 26 million people, that's growth, man.
It's good business. It's yeah. Good business.
What is your goal? Just keep
world
going?
Domination.
Just keep going, right?
To the moon.
True. I mean, you are.
In 2007, Biederman became CEO and found himself in the middle of a media storm.
But I'm not necessarily encouraging infidelity. I don't think it needs all that much encouragement.
How are you not encouraging infidelity?
8 years. Noel Biederman appeared continuously on TV chat shows defending and promoting the site. He called himself the king of infidelity. His wife, Amanda, also took part in the promotions.
I see it as a platform that helps people stay married. It helped millions of people find contentment, passion, and happiness.
Noel said that society was changing, the model of relationships that we have from the past and at the moment isn't working. A lot of people are having affairs and it's all done behind people's backs. It's destructive for families. And they said that they were leading the way in helping with this.
I was separated from my wife. I was working a lot. It's hard to meet people.
Christopher was looking for a like-minded woman to have an affair with.
The big attraction to it was that it's a hookup, it's not a date. There isn't any of the risk. You know, everybody knows where they stand.
It was definitely more geared towards sort of the, as I like to say, the afternoon delight kind of situation, kind of a quick hookup kind of site.
Like any dating site, users had to choose profile names and fill in their preferences.
Experimenting with tantric sex. One-night stands.
Although these choices were a little more direct than usual.
Likes to be watched, cuddling and hugging, and erotic movies. Sounds like an interesting weekend.
Tamsin is a marketing consultant and a serial mistress. She has chosen affairs over committed relationships most of her life.
Initially, you know, men are very hesitant to make the first move. When we start talking, that's the first thing, is they want to find out, you know, are you real? Or do you really live in the United States?
And that's when I would start getting emails saying that this woman checked out your profile. She wants to talk to you. This person's interested in you. And because if you didn't have a paid account, you didn't buy the credits, you couldn't see the actual pictures or the profiles. They were all blurred.
Men had to buy credits in order to reply to messages sent to them.
And then once you start talking, inevitably, for some strange reason, men have this insatiable desire to send you dick pictures, pictures of their penises. Sometimes it's even the first picture. I don't even know what their face looks like.
Okay.
People have affairs and cheat for a lot of different reasons. And it's not always just physical. We all like to think it's that, but in reality, even men, the vast majority, are seeking out an affair for emotional reasons as well.
I did meet and talk to quite a few men, a lot of politicians, a lot of corporate CEOs, a lot of guys that are in middle management, just not happy. Yeah, I mean, that was one thing about Ashley Madison. You got everything from construction workers and students. So it was pretty interesting.
People want more from their relationship, more from their life, and not feeling ashamed to be honest about what they really want. People are going to have affairs anyway. It's always happened. It's on an increase. It wasn't in the workplace. It wasn't with close friends of the family. You know, I got that concept. It's less damaging, and people's needs get met.
AshleyMadison.com was bought by another of Noel's companies, Avid Life Media, in 2007. Their promotional videos gave a veneer of corporate acceptability to otherwise niche products. 2 years later, they created EstablishedMen.com and CougarLife.com, calling them innovative dating services. But the main moneymaker was always Ashley Madison.
I'm looking for someone other than my wife. Other than my wife. Ashley Madison's right.
Ashley Madison became known for their cheeky, often outrageous, press campaigns.
Other than my wife.
This cheesy advert was banned by Australian regulators.
Looking for someone other than my wife. Other than my wife. Ashley Madison's right.
They courted controversy around the world, translating their glossy ads everywhere they went.
Das Leben ist kurz. Gönn dir eine Affäre.
In 2009, Tiger Woods was caught cheating on his wife. Within a week, Ashley Madison had offered to pay him $5 million to be the face of the brand. He didn't take the money, but 4 months later, they had sponsored the Tiger Woods mistress pageant on the Howard Stern show.
Here's our guest judge, Noel Biederman. The dude put up $100,000.
It seemed that no gimmick was too tabloid.
She is mistress number four.
The peculiar genius, not just of their marketing efforts, but I think of the leadership, seems to be able to take any thing, even negative news, and turn it into a promotional opportunity.
You are Tiger Woods' mistress, you are. Here comes Noel Biederman with a check for $75,000.
Despite the 2008 economic downturn, Ashley Madison appeared to be recession-proof. By 2015, Avid Life Media announced that they had grossed $115 million in the previous year, up 45%. Pre-tax profits came in at $55 million. But then, on 19th of July last year, everything changed. Brian Krebs, a tech journalist, revealed that Ashley Madison had been hacked. Employees had opened their computers to find an illustrated message on their screens. The Impact Team hackers threatened to publish stolen data unless Ashley Madison and Established Men shut down their controversial websites.
The consequences for not complying, as noted in this threat, would be the release of Ashley Madison and Established Men client lists, including their names, client profiles, and credit card data.
By the time I read the story, it had been, it was all over the world. I think every major news agency has already covered it within 6 to 12 hours.
Avid Life Media has been fully cooperating with the police investigation. This hack is one of the largest data breaches in the world.
They have a request that you contact the RCMP.
I was in a meeting, and all of a sudden, my phone started dancing across the table. And I'm trying to concentrate, and I'm looking over, and I'm seeing the names of business associates, my business clients, friends of mine, people I had met on Ashley Madison contacting me. And my heart sank.
The hack appeared very strange because it was so Hollywood-esque, as if it had been scripted. Crazily so. I mean, when you cover hacks all the time, it's always very dry. Nobody's very interested in the details of how they actually got the data and spread it. But this was different.
The Impact Team gave Avid Life 30 days to shut down their sites, enough time for the media to get into a frenzy.
The hackers were blackmailing the threat of more data to come.
Everyone was desperate to know who was using the world's number one website for adultery. When the company didn't comply, over 30 million user details were released. Across Across the world, suspicious partners frantically tried to find out if their partner was among them. One Australian radio show went a step further. They were happy to help trawl through the data dump, live on air.
Thing came on the news about the Ashley Madison hack. He sort of went a bit funny, and I thought, you've got his details.
We've got his details here, and his details have revealed that he's actually on the website, Joe.
Are you serious?
Yeah, I'm sorry.
Are you freaking kidding me?
The ripple effect of the impact team's actions has and will continue to have a long-term social and economic impacts, and they have already sparked spin-offs of crimes and further victimization.
I had quite a few of the gentlemen that I had met and talked to, their wives were decimated and hurt, and they wanted to talk.
As of this morning, we have two unconfirmed reports of suicides that are associated because of the leak of Ashley Madison's customers' profiles.
This is being covered as if the CIA had been hacked. What is so interesting here that somebody would want to do this?
Fair lipstick, who is she?
Many celebrities, politicians, religious leaders, and military personnel were reported to be members.
Just tell me her name, you might as well tell me.
This was brought to my wife's attention. She has forgiven me for this mistake that I made. I've sought forgiveness to God, and he's forgiven me. So I've been completely cleansed of this sin.
After the frenzy around user identities had died down, the media turned its attention to the business itself. It became obvious that Avid Life Media profited from a wide range of websites. And not all of them were dating services. Ashley Madison's meteoric rise continued unabated. And by 2015, they claimed to have over 30 million users.
Who are you talking to?
They even launched their very own Affair Anywhere mobile app and brazenly spread the word across the globe. But on the 19th of July, the site was hacked with catastrophic effects. It would become one of the largest cyber breaches of all time.
Multiple sites are now being downloaded. Nobody is going to be able to erase that information.
But despite the sensitivity of the website, we now know that Ashley Madison was warned of security vulnerabilities a number of times before the 2015 scandal. The Philippines has become an unlikely global cyber hotspot. Jason Zabate is a Filipino hacker. He managed to infiltrate the website in the months before the disastrous hack of July 2015.
Just checking Ashley Madison website. I tried to hack it. I checked the code and find what is the flaw or weaknesses.
Jason is part of an international community of cyber bounty hunters known as White Hat Hackers.
My job is to help keep company secure. I don't want to be a black hat. I'm not a bad guy.
These hackers can make a lot of money by showing large companies where their vulnerabilities lie. Jason pays his university fees this way. He found a way into Ashley Madison relatively quickly.
I have found cross-site scripting and bypassing cross-site request forgery that allow an attacker to change profile details.
Jason told Avid Life Media he had managed to find a flaw in their security, and they paid him a small fee in return for information. But it was too late. The impact team of hackers had apparently been accessing the site for a long time before Jason got there.
Impact team claimed they'd been watching the site grow for some time into the tens of millions of users, and they said they wanted to stop the next 60 million customers. They likened Avid Life Media to a drug dealer abusing addicts.
Joseph Cox believes he is the only journalist to have had contact with the impact hackers themselves.
Impact team said that when they hacked Ashley Madison, no one was watching, as in there were very few security barriers to getting into the network. They also said it was possible to hop from different parts of the network with a very simple password. And this has been in the work for some time. They've said that they had been exfiltrating the data over a number of years.
Ashley Madison talked a good game about their security, but as we've seen, the security wasn't really top of their agenda. What was top of their agenda was making money.
Jeremy Bullock is a data analyst who used the information released in the hack to analyse Ashley Madison's business practices. He was one of the first to identify the company's use of fembots. When he looked at the email addresses of users, he discovered 837 individual members that all shared the same email address. These seem to be fake profiles who were programmed to contact real users. They have also been called engagers, or Iconians.
These were algorithms that enabled Ashley Madison to contact gullible men pretending to be available women and made them part with money.
Iconians would send messages to users of the site. In order for men to chat back, they would have to pay.
Why 837 rather than 80,000? Because they didn't need 80,000. You could move these 837 around, you could make them different. They were programs now. They didn't have to be manually manipulated. Very, very clever.
They made it sound like it was this playland of people hooking up and, you know, there's millions of women here and they're all interested in you. I had contact with probably around 200 profiles. And out of that, I believe I spoke with one actual person.
But the idea that bots and fake profiles were on the pages of Ashley Madison was not new. As early as 2008, consumer attorney Filippo Marchino was preparing a case against Avid Life Media on behalf of disgruntled users.
One of the first things we did is we pulled the terms and conditions off of the website of Ashley Madison. And buried in the middle was a couple of sentences that read something to the extent of, this is only an entertainment website. You may be responding or contacted by robots. And that just did not sound right because people were not engaging AshleyMadison.com to talk to robots. That was not the crux of the idea.
Filippo then came across AshleyMadisonSucks.com, a sounding board for unhappy customers. He discovered that Biderman's company, Avid Life Media, was taking legal action against the site.
We thought that AshleyMadisonSucks.com was a rightful forum for people to voice their opinions, and it was no way violative of the rights of the trademark AshleyMadison.com.
Filippo agreed to represent the owner of AshleyMadisonSucks.com.
What happened then is that things got strange. The proverbial shit hit the proverbial fan, if you will. We became the target of online activities that couldn't really be traced back to anybody, but that were borderline bully, if you will.
Suddenly, web pages were created blackmailing Filippo's client and threatening him if he didn't take down AshleyMadisonSucks.com. False things were written about Filippo, his client, family members, and even his employees. Anonymous emails were sent with further threats and untrue allegations. One suggested Filippo's client had HIV.
We were never actually able to trace back who these emails were coming from, but it all started occurring right at the same time. It seemed to be a coordinated attack to dissuade my client from proceeding with what he was doing.
In a separate effort to get the site shut down, Noel Biderman offered the owner of AshleyMadisonSucks.com money for the IP address. He repeated his demands in a phone call recorded by the owner and in the presence of two witnesses.
Give me the URL back. I offered you 10 grand. You're being an ass.
I'm being a schmuck. You send an email to
you. You have no idea. Yeah. Just wait to the world of hurt I bring on you. Just wait.
I found out on the news that they had been hacked and all their information had been dumped. And I was very surprised to find out that some documents which had been exchanged between us and them, which otherwise should have been confidential, were now public domain.
email my girlfriend and tell her that you're putting up a site about her and that she may have HIV.
I'm gonna do so much worse to you. You're messing with my livelihood. You chose to be an ass. I'm being one back, but I can be 10 times more. I have way more resources than you. You got 24 hours, my friend. I'm gonna drag you to the mud.
The first dump of information by the impact team of hackers revealed information about many users of the site, but the hack didn't end there.
It seemed on the surface to be cut and dry. Here is a company, it's been hacked, here are all the victims, there's the story, the end. It should have blown over, but it didn't.
What came then took the hack to the next level.
Plenty of data breaches. Take customer data, email addresses, passwords, maybe some other customer information. And depending on the website, that can be relatively easy. But to get emails, product source code, internal documents, the hacker really has to take several more steps and really penetrate a company's network.
The second dump of information related to the company and the CEO himself.
Because there was so much email. I mean, it was every email from 2011, 2012, all the way till June 2015. A lot of email. I'm totally guessing here, but what it looked like, somebody had thrown a USB stick in someone's computers and just dragged over email files. It looked less like a hack than a copy.
Not all data breaches become public. I mean, probably most of them don't become public. But the fact that anybody could log on to a website on the so-called dark web, download this data and see it for themselves, I mean, that's appealing.
I start looking through the emails because I was interested in seeing if I could figure out who would do it. I wanted to figure out who did it. Well, then I became an addict.
But as Gina, the editor of anewdomain.com, looked through the emails, more questions came up.
Soon, I was just looking in the email trying to figure out, what was Ashley Madison? Was it really a dating site? It didn't appear so.
Avid Life Media, the parent company of Ashley Madison and headed by Noel Biderman, owned a lot of different websites through many different shell companies. Some of these, like Established Men and Cougar Life, were publicly part of the portfolio. And some of them weren't so obviously linked to Avid Life Media.
It isn't one dating site. It's many sites in every major market around the world. It's really a sprawling business and a sprawling collection of websites that appear to be designed to get people to come in to do other stuff. And that stuff doesn't seem to have a lot to do with dating.
The company owned websites that seemed to cater for every conceivable male fantasy. Each one was slick and targeted at a specific market.
So yes, there's, you know, married women who will have an affair with you, that's Ashley Madison. There's older women who have an affair with younger guys, that's Cougar Life. Broke college girls, find a broke college girl, like, you know, maybe you can be her sugar daddy. There's that site, there's bondage sites, there's gay sites. There's, I mean, if you find a male fantasy, there's a site for it.
All these websites had one aim, to draw in male customers. Ashley Madison user Tamsin could see how people got drawn onto other websites.
I think it's become sort of a gateway drug, if you will, for relationships and websites and internet dating of this sort, that it's a good area and a good site for people to sort of get their feet wet. And then once they're there, then the banners for the more directed websites pop up.
One of Avid Life's most popular websites was Established Men. It claims to be the premier online dating service that connects young, beautiful women with rich, successful men. The website makes it clear women cannot advertise their services as an escort. However, many female users are looking for a mutually beneficial arrangement, an MBA, a common online term for a relationship often involving money.
A lot of times women are looking for arrangements because they're having difficulty making ends meet. And a lot of times men are not in a position to have a formal relationship with all the bells and whistles and responsibilities that go along with it.
Marketing consultant Tamsin has lived an arrangement lifestyle on and off since she was 19.
This is more of a situation where the man provides the woman with an allowance, spoiling, takes care of her travel expenses, enables her to basically be able to be on his schedule on an as-needed basis.
Like the term sugar daddy, a mutually beneficial arrangement is a relationship where men and women negotiate the terms.
A lot of those are escorts, right? Some of them just boldly say escorts, but escort services are illegal in the United States outside of a couple of areas. So you can't really come out and say, hey, I'm a hooker. Yeah, it's illegal.
Avid Life Media also owns arrangementfinders.com, a more blatantly erotic website. Even though the website states that it doesn't allow escorts to use the service, they actively encourage girls who would like some extra income through dating to join.
Start dating the way evolution programmed you to. We can ship bubbles right to you.
They created another tongue-in-cheek marketing campaign, this time with the porn star Caden Cross as the face of the brand.
We're not just creating arrangements, we're also creating new jobs. Bubbles, what were you doing last month?
No jobs.
And what are you doing this month?
Low jobs.
When they deliberately advertised outside a university, they made the news again. People were stunned.
Santa Monica Boulevard near Overland Avenue.
A spokesperson for Avid Life Media says the placement and the timing for the ad is part of the company's strategy. With graduation right around the corner and students looking for jobs and money, when we asked if this was prostitution, the spokesperson said no, it's intimacy with a twist.
But emails in the dump, purporting to be from Noel Biderman's inbox, reveal that the company not only knew they hosted escorts, they actively sought them. In one case, it appeared that 2,500 escorts were emailed, enticing them to join Arrangement Finders. When it worked, they planned to contact 45,000 more. Some emails discussed the possibility of bringing foreign women to the US to work as sugar babies, and how the company would market them. They also investigated how the women could come to the US by lying to the authorities. ArrangementFinders.com is one of Avid Life's most successful sites, and it was to take Noel Biderman and Avid Life Media in a new direction: movies. He experimented with product placement and an unknown starlet. It just happened to be in hardcore porn. The site is also known for its shocking, deliberately provocative marketing stunts. This ad from 2013, featuring zombie husbands and wives, was banned, buying the company even more free publicity.
Bringing your marriage back to life.
But the owners of Ashley Madison, Avid Life Media, have a loose definition of dating.
It's so simple, a caveman could use it.
In their deliberately lo-fi styled advert for ArrangementFinders.com, Caden Cross, face of the brand, explains what they do.
It's a dating site for all you sexy silverbacks out there who think it's time for a little arm candy. It's also a dating site for all those arm candies out there who think it's time for a little purse candy. Are these dating options any good, you ask? No. But blowjobs are f***ing great.
The company have denied this is prostitution, but rather intimacy with a twist. ArrangementFinders.com is interesting for an additional reason. This is the website that took the CEO, Noel Biderman, and his team into the world of pornography.
I took some photos of myself in a state of undress in a bank on Wall Street. And then the photos went viral. The bathroom was not public, it was a private bathroom. And I used to take pictures in there, like when I'm bored anyway, just because I'm a millennial and we do things like that. And within days, literally days, they went completely viral over the internet. And I was dubbed the Wall Street porn star before I had even decided if I wanted to do porn or not. But at that point, it was I was committed, right?
You got the Ashley Madison investment, right?
Yeah, and we're working on some other interesting stuff.
Veronica Vane would become Noel Biderman's leading lady. Screwing Wall Street, the Arrangement Finders IPO, was the first fully branded porn film, sort of not-so-subtle product placement. Veronica was offered the lead part as her porn debut. The story was a spoof on the original Hollywood film, Wall Street.
You want to work for me?
The reason I was really interested in this deal, I knew that it was pretty groundbreaking what they were doing, even if it wasn't necessarily the best way to go about it at the time. The fact that they were doing it and that they were a mainstream brand.
Now you are good enough to get in my office. Let's see if you're good enough to stay.
That movie really wasn't the goldmine for him. He wasn't looking for, you know, to have his brand in porn. Just the fact that it was my name and I was this girl who was being portrayed as being, you know, young and like cute and having a good head on her shoulders. I was the girl he wanted to sell to all these guys.
The plan worked very well. The clips that were released for free have had over 3 million views. But it was Veronica's association with the brand and appearances on legitimate news channels that really had an effect.
I always wanted to do something more entrepreneurial with my career. I knew I wasn't a fit for a more conservative environment, and I saw an industry that's undergoing a new wave of innovation, and I really wanted to be a part of that. The site had about a 200% increase in overall web traffic, but more impressively, a 400% increase in signups. Which I think is basically saying that if you were going to arrangement finders as a result of seeing me in this clip or in the media or something, you're almost immediately converting into a member.
It was another major marketing success for Noel Biderman.
Why do you think Noel is so clever at this?
Speaking as an entrepreneur myself, most entrepreneurs, when they come up with an idea, it's because they saw a market need for something that they needed. Like, most entrepreneurs don't just like, oh, people need this, but I don't really want it. Like, most entrepreneurs, when they start something, they want the product. That's why they're making it. So I can only imagine that he might have wanted to have some sort of affair, make it easier to have affairs. And it's quite brilliant that he went to market being like, I don't have an affair. I'm happily married, blah, blah, blah. I just like started this for other guys.
If your husband was cheating on you, would you be okay with him going to a site such as yours?
Absolutely not. That's not what I signed up for.
Noel was the master of press interviews. He often included his wife in the discussion.
And I live in a traditional situation with Noel, and we...
And he was always clear. He had never had an extramarital affair.
And I would be devastated if he did it to me.
But information released in the Ashley Madison hack revealed that Noel did have affairs. In fact, it appeared that over 3 years, he had relationships with a number of women, many of whom he had met through his own site, Established Men. Noel frequently discussed money with these women and even offered one work at Avid Life. He appears to have been a serial sugar daddy himself. It seems that very little of the Ashley Madison story was as it appeared. It's hard to know if the mainstream media would have given Noel and his company quite so much airtime if they'd known all that was happening behind the scenes.
I don't think Ashley Madison is inventing prostitution. I think what the emails suggest they're doing is helping to automate it and making it very easy. Just like Google didn't invent looking stuff up. To my knowledge, Ashley Madison, they're not running a prostitution ring or their own escort service that's against the law or anything like that. What I find more immoral is about the way they deal with reporters and journalists, you know, misleading them into thinking the company is something that it isn't. But that's not illegal or either, because they're a private company and they can tell people anything they want to about their business.
I think Ashley Madison were brilliant at marketing. They seemed to know what the papers wanted, and they would take this little seed of truth and blow it up, and that was probably what made them so successful in the media.
You need to get a little bit more with the times. And to
Louise
honest,
Vandeveld is a professional sex and relationship counsellor. She was employed by Ashley Madison as a media spokesperson in 2013, although she soon fell out with the company over money. But she did get an insight into how the company worked.
Because the relationship model is fundamentally flawed from the off.
When I first agreed to be their spokesperson, it was very much me coming from an authentic point of view about my beliefs, about my experience of working with couples that have had affairs. A lot of that kind of got ditched, and they took the glamorised, shocking headline approach.
And the hacked emails revealed not just exaggeration, but deliberate deception of the media. Even blue chip publications fell for their stories.
Forbes is one of the world's largest financial publications. It's one of the most respected financial publications in the world.
Noel and Avid Life Media were cultivating a relationship with a journalist who was trying to get a piece commissioned by the magazine.
Forbes editors had agreed to do an article about them and their fantastic growth, but they wanted to see some numbers. And from the trail of emails, you see employees saying, you know, whoa, well, you know, I can, you know, do up this chart and, you know, I can make up this set of data points. And, you know, a lot of it seems to have been largely invented.
The company appears to have dramatically exaggerated the financial figures for the Ashley Madison website.
All those websites, all those affiliate marketing deals, I mean, all the many different little revenue streams that Ashley Madison and Avid and its related companies have all over the world. But how could Forbes have known about all of that? And back then, nobody did.
No NSA.
Noel's dream was for Ashley Madison to be listed on the stock market and sell its shares to the public through what's called an IPO.
So it's a big company.
We're a huge company. Yeah. Maybe you can help us with the IPO. I think it's about time we go and raise $1 billion.
What about
and,
that?
Show the world.
That's interesting.
It could happen. If you looked at our business with a blind on it, right? You just looked at the numbers and the growth and the membership, you'd be like, oh my God, this thing is worth billions.
Noel wanted everyone to look at the business through a filter to cover the entire empire of sex sites, porn affiliates, and escort listings with the blanket of Ashley Madison.
Because Noel was like so good at making it seem so mainstream and okay and commonplace and like okay to talk about, like I think people were more likely to be able to talk openly about AshleyMadison.com than they are about Pornhub.com.
So if Forbes comes out and says, wow, Ashley Madison is one of the largest, most successful dating sites in history, it's nearly a $1 billion company, then eight other major publications the world over will say, wow, Forbes, Bloomberg, must be true. I mean, with nobody really questioning, you know, could this really be a $1 billion company? Is it really going public? 45% growth in 1 year, really? And you really can't blame Ashley Madison for taking advantage of a lazy press.
In September 2015, 2 months after the hack, another Forbes article was written. We really don't know how big Ashley Madison was, although I'm pretty sure that it was nowhere near as big as it seemed. But while the hack appears to have revealed so much about the users and owners of the website, we know very little about the hackers themselves. A year later, no one has been arrested for the crime, and the case is still ongoing.
Avid Life Media is offering a $500,000 reward to anyone providing information that leads to the identification, arrest, and prosecution of the person or persons responsible for the leak of the Ashley Madison database.
And no one has collected that $500,000 reward.
Stand by.
Good looking, healthy, certainly old enough to get married. What a lovely picture this bride and groom make. Each is a dream in the other's mind.
Many marriages were rocked when user details of AshleyMadison.com were leaked last year. Divorce lawyers claimed it was Christmas in September for the industry.
Why did it have to happen this way for them? Whose fault was it?
I want to move on and get a little
The dating industry was also rocked. Shortly after the hacked emails of Noel Biderman were published, Avid Life Media announced that he had agreed to step down as CEO. They said this was in the best interest of the company.
Team Impact, this is your wake-up call. Your actions are illegal, and we will not be tolerated.
But the police still have no idea who did it. The hackers called themselves the Impact Team, an anonymous-style group who called the users of Ashley Madison cheating dirtbags and accused Avid Life of profiting from the pain of others. This kind of hack is known as hacktivism. Near Manchester, is filled with people who know that world well.
If you understand the rules of somebody else's system better than they did, then you effectively get to rewrite the rules of the game.
Trying to take down a website that promotes unfaithfulness between couples, it's could be considered vigilantism.
Is it okay to cheat on your wife because you can do it like behind closed doors on this website? And then what happens when that is exposed? Are we all now supposed to feel sorry for you?
I personally would never do anything illegal, but when that Ashley Madison thing happened, I kind of was like, yeah, good on them.
A lot of big hacktivists, I mean, this is what they go for. They try to expose big corporate companies. The means of going in and shutting down some other site is still breaking the law.
It's getting serious. We're seeing more of the effect it would have on people's lives.
All right, so back to the lockpicking. So I'm here and I'm...
Hacker House was set up to try and bring hackers into the mainstream and not to break the law. But the Impact Team's action was more than just illegal.
Whether they thought the reasoning behind that was purely moral, only they could answer. But it's not like this was a victimless crime at all. I mean, people killed themselves.
We still have no idea who hacked Avid Life Media and for what true motive. It didn't appear to make money from the hack, so there must have been a different reason. Some people think it was a competitor.
I'm of the belief that it was probably a competing website that may have masterminded or saw the opportunity, may have planted an employee over a period of time, or they were the ones who handled the hack externally.
One theory was that it was an inside job.
There is a chance the Impact Team was just an insider. Judging by the quality and richness of the data, internal emails, product source code, they likely had to be on the company network itself rather than just the website.
I believe that someone had a personal problem with the CEO or the executives at the company and felt cheated in some way where they were getting revenge.
Judging by the way that I was treated by the company and the way that they just seemed used to dealing with employees that were, you know, not happy, I think it possibly was an inside job.
Lots of people could have had a motive to harm either Avid in general or Noel specifically. People inside, people outside. This was a company that sued a lot of people, fired a lot of people. I mean, finding a person with a motive is too easy. There's too many people with motives.
But whoever did it, the real-world impact of Ashley Madison continues.
Anybody who's been through what I've been through would love to see that site down.
Long before the hack, Ashley Madison had been helping to destroy marriages. Many of the real women on the site were from rural areas.
When the hack happened, you can actually go and see per area, Utah, you know, Idaho, where they had some of the highest Ashley Madison accounts. And these are conservative rural areas. It's something that actually is not very surprising to me.
In 2012, several years before the hack, Jim received some messages on his phone. By accident, one of his wife's accounts was networked to his cell.
I started getting emails, and they were text messages between my wife and another guy telling him that I'm going to start a fight with my husband. I'm going to figure out some way to go meet up with you. I threw up. I actually threw up.
In the end, Jim was able to recover many of the messages his wife had sent.
Stuff you can never unknow, you can never unsee. There's a video. Someone sent me a video. It was her having sex.
Jim discovered that his wife had had affairs with six different men on the Ashley Madison website.
It's like a drug. It's like you're addicted and you just want more. You want that adrenaline, you want that feeling. That's the only way I can think of it. I have these five little kids. I did not want them to raise a broken home. I felt like it was my fault. I felt responsible. I just tried talking to her and explaining this. You know, I love you. What, you know, we have five kids. Let's not destroy this family.
But in the end, it was impossible to reconcile. The couple divorced.
It took a long time before I stopped getting nauseous. Like physically wanted to throw up anytime I saw Ashley Madison. Until the hack, That was a good day.
We don't know who did the hack, but we do know that the impact team has threatened to do more attacks.
I asked impact team whether they were going to hit any other companies, and they said, essentially, sure, maybe there might be politicians.
All system have weaknesses. Even the biggest social networking site. There's no such thing as a secure system.
As more of our lives become intertwined with the digital world, cars having connections to the internet, for example, hacking is only going to increase.
Is that scary?
Yeah.
Greetings, citizen of the free world. Our freedom is once again under attack. This cannot continue.
All that love.